So now let's take a look at some of the things that go into planning your Azure virtual networks. It's fairly important that you put a little bit of thought process into what you're going to do with Azure Virtual Network prior to actually beginning to build your solution, because it becomes difficult to change some of this stuff after the fact. You know, it's like any network. Once you lay down the basic network and you begin to build applications on top of it, making substantial changes can be challenging. So you want to make sure you put a little bit of thought into this first. So before you go in, you've got something you know is going to work and is going to last long term. So for example, what locations are you going to deploy your application in? Is this just the US or is this global? US, Europe, Australia? Do you need to connect those different locations? Are you deploying independent isolated things, or do those three locations or four locations need to have internal connectivity to each other? Do I need to connect my own data center to Azure? How many VMs, roles, etc. am I going to have? Am I going to have two or three or 2,000 or 3,000? Do I need to isolate traffic? Do I need to create rules to restrict the types of traffic flow between various types of networks? Am I going to be using appliances such as firewalls or packet inspection devices as opposed to just port filtering, which is built into Azure? And then who administers all of this? Do I have a global administrator that does everything? Do I have teams that need to administer only portions of it? These are all questions that you want to ask yourself as part of planning your implementation of Azure networking. So once you've gone through and you've kind of asked all these questions, we got to begin to understand the basic building blocks of Azure networking. Now, the first one is a VNet. A VNet is a logical representation of your environment stored in Azure. So it's a logical overall network. If you were to, for example, say, well, I have a building and I want to put a network in that building, that's the equivalent of defining a VNet. At its most basic form, it's a very large TCP/IP subnet range that has isolation, meaning it's completely isolated, internet communication. It has default routing rules, so any subnets that are in this VNet, they can talk to each other. It has VPN capability. It has network security groups that can be built within it to filter traffic, and routing is all fully automatic. Now, every VNet is going to contain at least one subnet, and in the most simple implementations, you know, you might have one VNet, one subnet, and they're all the exact same address range. It's very simple. In more complex implementations, you might have multiple VNets, each containing many subnets with relatively complex routing relationships between them. It's entirely up to you what you want to do. For your VNet, there's some basic properties. A name, a location. The address space is the TCP/IP subnet insider notation. This is, for example, 10.0.0.1/8, where /8 is the equivalent of like 255.0.0.0. So it's a CIDR notation subnet. At least one subnet, and then whatever DNS servers you're going to use and whatever DHCP servers you're going to use. So any options you want passed out through DHCP is automatic within a VNet, so you can assign options. And then if you're going to use Azure's built-in DNS server, or you're going to go in and put your own DNS solution in place, you can simply tell the VNet, here's the IP of the DNS you're going to use. And whenever you get a DHCP address from within the VNet, it'll include the appropriate DNS server. A subnet is a child of a VM, sorry, of a VNet. And this is, it looks kind of the same. But VNets are larger objects. VNets contain subnets, and you can have many subnets within a single VNet and use network security groups to control routing between these subnets. And so here's some of the properties for a subnet. You have the name, the location, the address prefix, again, insider notation, any network security group. And we'll talk about what these groups are here in a second. The routing table, if you want to do custom routing, and then any IP configurations you want assigned to that subnet. A network security group is a list of rules that you can allow or deny. Many people, when they first kind of look at network security groups, they think of them as a firewall. They're not really a firewall, though that's one of the functions they serve. It's a list of rules. And that list of rules can be assigned to a subnet or an interface. So if you think about this, you can create one kind of master list that represents the general rules on the traffic that you allow within your VNet, and you can assign that to all the subnets in your VNet. You can then take individual VMs, create an additional network security group specific to that virtual machine and assign it to only those interfaces, thereby further restricting those VMs, giving them custom restrictions based on the role that, they're playing. For example, you may allow HTTP everywhere within all your subnets, but not allow it or block it on domain controllers. So that would be one overall network security group for all the subnets, and then a second network security group assigned to only a domain controller blocking HTTP. And you can see the, you know, the process here, it's a pretty straightforward process. Is it matched by a rule? If it is, allow it. If it's not, don't allow it. And the properties of a rule, this is your typical, what they call a five-tuple packet filtering rule. Protocol, source port, destination port, source address range, destination address range, are the five characteristics of a protocol. Now, it's worth noting that there is no ICMP. ICMP is enabled by default with the allow all traffic within the subnet rule, so you can ping within a subnet. If you want to enable ICMP for the protocol, you simply use an asterisk, and that will enable ICMP in places where it's blocked. So inbound, outbound direction, and then there's a priority number, so you can stack the rules. So you can put a least restrictive rule with a higher priority, it'll get evaluated first. A more restrictive rule with a lower priority, it'll get evaluated further down the chain. So there's an art form to building these, and for folks that are familiar with building, you know, switch rules or firewall rules, they should be pretty familiar with this, with how this works and the general process behind it. So here's some examples of some VNet designs, right? So I've got a subscription, and in this I've got two applications in this first example over here. I've got app one and I've got app two. And so I've got a VNet for the production app one, a VNet for development of app one, a VNet for production of app two, and a VNet for development of app two. Here's another example of the exact same scenario. Two applications. App one is in subscription one, app two is in subscription two, and I've got one VNet in each, production and dev. And then here's another example right here. I've got two business units. Each business unit has an application, or has two applications. And so this is a larger version of that first example. So you can see from this, there's many ways that you can choose to implement it. And in most cases, how you choose to implement, you know, the structure of VNets is more often determined by the business rules of the company than any hard technical requirements. Because you can implement filtering and protocols and ports and subnets and the VM connectivity almost any way you want. The management of the VNets and the isolation often comes down to business rules more so than technical rules. So these are examples where we've got multiple subscriptions, multiple business units, multiple applications, and just different ways that you can implement it. And you take that exact same concept, and here's some examples of how we can apply subnets and network security groups. So in this example here, I've got two applications. Each application has a front-end component and a back-end component. So in the first example, I've got four network security groups on one subnet. So all the application data is on a single subnet, single IP range, and I've got four network security groups governing which components can speak to which. Second one, I've got two subnets. So I've got each application on a different subnet, and each subnet has two network security groups, with front-end, back-end, front-end, back-end. Now, with this example right here, it's worth noting that if these applications are the same, so let's say they're both, you know, web apps that talk to a SQL database, I could conceivably get away with creating only two network security groups. So I can create one network security group, which is allow web server traffic. I could assign that network security group to both applications. I'd create a second that is allow SQL traffic and assign that to both applications. And in the other example, the third example, I've got the subnet one is all the front end components for both apps. Subnet 2 is all the back-end components for both apps. So again, point being, there's a lot of various ways that you can do this. Really, the creativity is up to you. So planning IP address and subnet allocation, when you think about how you will do IP addressing. So number one, both private and public non-overlapping address space. Make sure that you, throughout the entirety of all your virtual networks, use different IP address subnets and scopes for everything. If you have US and Australia, don't use, you know, 10.0.0.0/8 in both locations, because that will prevent you from connecting them together down the road. For everything you put in, assume that you're going to connect them together at some stage down the road and isolate them and have different subnets accordingly. For all subnets, the first three IP addresses and the last are not available for use. The first allocated by DHCP is the fourth IP, and the smallest you can specify is a 29-bit subnet mask. Okay, so first three are unavailable, the last one is unavailable, and typically if you do, for example, a subnet of 10.0.0.0, the first IP you'll get will be 10.0.0.4. Use static private IP addresses whenever you can. It's just a, you know, static things are, it's a best practice unless you know you're going to need that flexibility. For subnets that use static IP addresses, keep them separate from subnets that use dynamic IP addresses. So if you have two subnets within your network, on one subnet use only static, on one subnet use only dynamic. There's no technical reason for this. Experience, you know, from people that have done this have dictated this is just easier to manage long term. Because you know, it's you're able to predict with a little more accuracy how the addresses are going to get assigned. And then for all subnets, routing is automatic. So if you have two subnets in a VNet, the routing is fully automatic. You don't got to worry about it. They'll all be able to talk to each other. You don't need to deploy routers or configure routers. It's all fully automatic. So the next thing you've got to think about is name resolution. Okay, so this is DNS. How do you want to implement name resolution for your virtual machines in Azure? The first thing to keep in mind is that Azure provides built-in DNS capability. So if you deploy virtual machines on a VNet, you can perform name resolution between those VMs in the same VNet automatically. Azure provides that basic DNS functionality. There are two other options that you have. You can put your own DNS server in Azure. So I can stand up a VM, install DNS, and use it as my DNS for Azure. Number two, I can use an external DNS server. Now, an external DNS server could be something like, you know, Network Solutions, or a DNS server that's in my office, or I can deploy, and we'll look at this later in the course, an Azure-based DNS server. So in all cases, here's some scenarios what the best option is. So if I have two VMs on the same network, just let Azure take care of it. It's automatic. If I have a multiple role instances or multiple VMs, but they're in the same VNet, but they're in different services, the recommendation there is using your own DNS implementation. Between VM role, VMs in Azure and on-premises computers, use your own DNS server, right? So you want your own DNS implementation. Between VMs on different VNets. So I've got two VNets, two different locations. Use your own, you implement DNS, you'll govern the resolution that way. Between on-premise and public endpoints, external DNS, so public DNS. And then if you want to use reverse lookup of any type, you've got to use your own DNS for that. So pretty straightforward list, recommendations on how you do DNS or how you do name resolution. So that's our look at some of the things we've got to think about before we put our first virtual network in Azure. Pretty straightforward. Do your planning up front. Do all the thinking up front. Design everything out on paper on a whiteboard first. Diagram it in Visio. Once it's done, begin building the objects. Now, what we'll look at in the next section or the next module is how we begin to create those objects in Azure.